So, hi, I'm Vid Stojevic. I'm the CTO of GTN. And GTN stands for Generative Tensorial Networks. And that's the name for our technology. That, so we're combining ideas from quantum physics and machine learning and deep learning in order to advance drug discovery. So our founding team is Noor, who is going to speak a little later. She's the CEO. She was a professor of machine learning in Denmark, interested in particular in generative networks. She has 50 publications and over 1,000 citations. And I did my PhD in string theory and then worked for the last 5-6 years in kind of simulations of many-body quantum physics. And so we're, like I said, trying to combine these ideas to advance drug discovery. So I'll first tell you a little bit about the technological idea, so what the connections between quantum mechanics and machine learning are. And then Noor will tell you a little bit more about the pharma side of things and the company. So what are the connections between machine learning and quantum mechanics? So quantum mechanics is, in some sense, very simple, or the fundamental equation looks very simple. So states correspond to vectors. So physical state is given by vector. And just if you remember, it's useful to remember that this object here stands for a vector notationally for the next 5 minutes. So it's a linear differential equation that determines the evolution of these vectors. The object H there corresponds to the Hamiltonian. It describes the energy of the system. So apparently, there's nothing very complicated about quantum mechanics. But of course, everybody knows that's not quite true. So the question is, where do the complications come in? And really, it becomes complicated simply, I mean, if you take seriously the fact that in quantum mechanics, physical states correspond to vectors, then presumably you can add these vectors and you can take tensor product of these vectors. And that's really where all the weirdness that you hear about in quantum mechanics comes from. So if you add vectors, you're allowed superpositions. And that means, so it's things like the Schrodinger's cat kind of thought experiment where the cat can be both alive and dead comes from this property. But the even weirder thing is the kind of tensor product part of the story. So here, this is kind of an example of a simplest possible quantum system, which corresponds to the spin of a single particle. So you're not worried about where the particle is, just can point either up or down or be in a superposition. And the question is, how do you represent many such particles together? And the answer is you have to take tensor products. So if you take a tensor product of two, just for a two-particle state, the two-particle state is represented by a matrix in general. And this matrix can't be decomposed as a tensor product of one particle and another particle in general. That's only true for very special states. So most states live in this superposition where you can't disentangle one particle from another. And it's called entanglement, and it's really something that it's very hard to think about in an intuitive way. And the problem computationally with many-body systems like this is that the cost, because of this tensor product structure, the cost of representing a state of, say, n particles is exponential in the number of particles. So these pictures here really are, so in order to represent an n particle state, you need to work with the tensor with n legs, which really means only, all that means is that, I mean, the tensor is just a multidimensional array in the sense of what you know, what you can define in Python. But of course, the memory cost of that is exponential in the rank of the array. So essentially, physicists have been kind of confronting this curse of dimensionality for a while. And one of the answers is, once quantum computers come along, they'll be able to sort this out. But nevertheless, the situation is kind of, here is where the analogy with machine learning comes in. So the point is that physically relevant states, like if you want to understand something that's actually physically relevant, so that lives at low energies, and then it's not really necessary to take into account this whole huge exponential space. And that's exactly the same kind of thing as when you say doing image recognition. Your network doesn't need to take into account every possible image. In fact, a random image just looks like white noise. It's only an exponentially small subspace of all possible images that looks like anything around us in the real world. And it's the same story in physics. So if you care about low energy states, you can decompose your state into what's called a tensor network. And this tensor network is often not exponentially expensive. So you go from exponential to polynomial costs. Which all that means is that kind of correlations are local. what I'm doing here in physics doesn't, you know, I'm not immediately influencing what's going on in Shepherd's Bush right now or something like that. So, so it's kind of, it's in general locality that saves you from this exponential cost at low energies. Now, so physicists have been working on this in constructing these kinds of tensor networks for the past 30, 35 years. So they've come up with various networks for various physical situations. One of them, this lowest one, is kind of reminiscent of a convolutional neural net in the sense that it looks at features on different scales. It's designed for kind of scale invariant systems. And okay, this is an analogy, but sort of over the past year and a half, people have realized that these two approaches are really kind of the same in some sense. You can actually use the physics sensor networks to address standard machine learning problems. And you can go vice versa and use deep neural networks and to understand quantum states. If you want to kind of simplify it to a very basic level, the only difference is the cost function. So in physics, you're dealing with a cost function that's trying to, for example, maybe minimize the energy. Whereas obviously in machine learning, you need to worry about the data input. But there's kind of also a sliding scale that's interesting because you can go, in physics, you might maybe not know everything about the operator about the kind of thing you want to minimize. So you might also have some data input. So it's kind of a combination of good priors versus data that these kind of structures can exploit nicely. So this is just kind of an I'm just trying to show that the interest in this overlap has exploded over the past year and a half. In academia, so maybe a year and a half ago there were two interesting papers. Right now, there's kind of a list online. There's probably, I don't know, 60 or 70 or something like that. Like I said, at GTN, we're interested in molecules. We're interested in small molecule drug design. So how small molecules bind to proteins, and we're trying to investigate these kinds of problems. So the question is how to use these tensor networks to represent molecules, and then how to incorporate this into a machine learning framework. So of course, the ball and stick picture of molecules is not the true representation of what's going on there, what's going on quantum mechanically. You need to take into account this crazy entangled structure between the electrons. And so generally, when you're talking about electrons, as opposed to some of the pictures that I showed you before, which look more like a kind of crystal structure, like tensor networks or crystal structures, the tensor networks that are appropriate for molecules look somewhat unlike the ball and stick picture. And that's because there's a lot of non-locality in molecules. And so it's a kind of slightly more difficult problem. And so that's kind of the general idea that, so the takeaway points of what I've said so far, somewhat simplified, somewhat overstated. So the best way to represent many-body quantum physics is using these tensor networks, which are closely related to deep neural nets. And you can actually put it more strongly, the tensor networks and the tensor networks used in many-body quantum physics are, in some sense, equivalent to deep neural nets. And there have been papers that kind of attempt to prove that equivalent in a mathematical sense. So they have the same representational power, but it's often kind of, they're not the same thing. So sometimes it's wiser to take one approach, and at other times it's wiser to look at, maybe standard machine learning approaches. And so combining complex inputs, such as input. So if your inputs are not images of some simple kind of data, but they're actual molecules, they're actual wave functions, then in order to have this kind of input data, you really need to work with both these things together, which is what we're trying to do in our company. And Noor will tell you a little bit more how this connects with pharma.
Right, can you hear me? My mic is working. So yeah, I'm gonna kind of repeat what Vid said, but in a higher level, not so technical way. So what we're trying to do with GTN is basically combining these three circles, combining machine learning, quantum physics, and applying it to pharmaceutical drug discovery. And we believe this unique combination is crucial in order to kind of solve the fundamental problems in drug discovery. So there's a video that tells you how the drug usually look like. And the red one is the protein, which is the drug, which is basically a chemical compound, should bind to. And there are a number of properties that this small molecule should have in order to be effective. So it should bind to a specific protein. It shouldn't bind to a number of others, basically not to cause side effects or other diseases. it should have a certain dose, it should be able, it should have a certain solubility and these kind of things. So it's basically two things. You need to find this molecule and you need it to have a certain number of properties. And that's basically what we're looking at. So if you look at drug discovery pipeline right now, it's kind of like this kind of diagram. It starts by screening millions of molecules. And they try to narrow them down so that when they move in within the drug discovery process from one step to another, they try to apply different filters to know which of the drug is effective, which of them bind to a protein, interact with a certain protein. And they try to apply these different filters in order to get to the end of this pipeline where they get one molecule or one drug that goes into the market. Right now, this whole process is quite inefficient. It costs $2.6 billion per drug, and it takes 15 years. And that's basically because of two main bottlenecks that I'm going to talk about in a minute. But what you're going to understand here as well is that it's basically ineffective because there are because of the very high attrition rate. So many of the molecules that reach the preclinical and the clinical stages, which are later in the process, they usually fail. And I would say many, it's like 92% of them will basically fail when they are tested on humans and animals because of not very accurate prediction of their activities. And these very low accuracy in predictions is basically because they're working the standard state of the art. In this area right now, basically works on a very simplified version of the molecules, which is basically bond and stick models. So they either represent molecules as strings, which is very, very simple representation if you look at how they actually are in nature, or they represent them as graphs. In reality, however, they look like this, which is basically a wave functions and quantum property that you have to take into account when you model these protein, when you model these molecules, and when you kind of want to generate new ones. But the other problem is that it's not only just the representation, it's also the amount, the huge search space that you have to look into when you're searching for molecules or for drugs that bind to a specific protein. And if you look at the number of the size of this space, it's 10 to the power of 80, which is just to give you an analogy, this number is more than the number of atoms in the entire universe. So it's a huge search space. So it's a very complex representation, and it's a huge space that you have to look into. So it's complexity within complexity if you want to look at a specific drug that binds to a specific protein. So we want to solve this problem. If you look at the state of the art, so for image recognition or for image generation, there's convolutional neural network and generative tensorial methods. For computational chemistry, for working with molecules, it's basically what's called convolutional graphs. And this basically, the graph in the middle is the one taken from a recent paper by Google. And our method is built on top of these, so we're trying to come up with new ways of dealing with this huge dimensional input space when we represent molecules as their wave function and their quantum properties. And then we will have also to come up with new ways of, or new algorithms, new methods that could work with this advanced representation. And that's basically what we're doing. So this is basically how our pipeline looks like. We start by training data sets of molecules that currently are represented as strings or as graphs. We advance this representation by taking it to the next level, which is basically the wave function. And then we build specific types. They kind of look like traditional deep learning, deep neural networks, but they are in the kind of, we're replacing some of the components in this network with something coming from tensorial methods. So you can imagine taking some of the nodes or some of the layers and replacing them with tensorial layers so that you can basically handle this very huge dimensional input space, and you can also build on top of that some sort of special autoencoders. Again, some of the layers are replaced with tensorial layers so that you can create new novel molecules and you can search this huge space of 10 to the power of 80 possible molecules. And then we create new ones, we can add them to our data sets, and we close kind of the loop in creating and training the models. Right now, so far we're kind of a small early stage startup. We are 6 months old and we have been doing this technology for the past 6 months. So far we have built this first step, which is predictive models. So basically predictions of molecular activities. So predicting how toxic the molecule is, how effective it is when binding to a protein and these kind of things. And we already achieving state-of-the-art results compared to the recent ones published by Google and Harvard when tested against publicly available data sets and against the method that has publicly been available. And our next step, which is basically we have started recently, is using this kind of specific autoencoders, like improved autoencoded encoders, which we called generative tensorial networks, to basically create a new instances or new novel modifications of certain molecules that have been proven to be effective, just to give kind of the computational chemist a way of being like creative when thinking about molecules. So chemists usually have like this what they call lead molecule that has shown to be kind of effective when dealing with a specific protein, and they want to improve it in a way to be more sensitizable or more kind of having less side effects. So we are able to provide a number of alternatives that they can work with. So we are, right now our team is like 3 people working full-time and part-time, and we have 5 advisors. And the reason I'm mentioning that we have world-class advisors is because we are hiring. So if you want to join like our team and work with like really world-class physicists and computational chemists, then please come and talk to us. And that's it. Thank you.